Let me ask you a question. Have you ever been humiliated? Humiliation can go from, I kind of humiliated myself with that thing, did it again, to major humiliation that, I can't believe I did that. Oh no, now everybody knows and I'm so humiliated. I want to talk to you this morning about how, whether a humiliation is a little thing or a big thing, how God can use that, and in his grace and kindness, he actually uses it because it's a part of the human condition, and he turns it into something good. So I want to talk to you this morning about how you can have hope even in your worst moments and the worst parts of you. Now, just to kind of set us up this morning, how many of you heard the story this week of some Australian DJs, Mel Gregg and Michael Christian, they're called Shock Jocks in Sydney, Australia. They work for a radio station called Today. It's an FM station, and they wanted to play a joke. And so what they did is they heard that Kate Middleton, the future Queen of England, was in the hospital with major complications. She's pregnant and sick. Everybody thought she's going to be okay, but she's in the hospital. And so they called the hospital. It's actually King Edward VII Hospital. They called the hospital, and they acted like they were Prince Charles calling and Queen Elizabeth. And the folks who answered the phone passed them through to a nurse. Her name was Jacinta Saldanha, and she took the call and believed that it actually was the Queen and Prince Charles. And so she talked a little bit about Kate and then patched them through to the nurse attending to Kate, who then spilled the beans, and all of this was live on the air in Australia. Well, they laughed and everybody laughed, and something happened afterwards. You see, there were two nurses who were totally humiliated. One of them is Jacinta there. And Lord Glenn Arthur, who is the chairman of the hospital, described it this way. He said the prank humiliated two dedicated and caring nurses, and the consequences were beyond tragic. You see, in her humiliation, Jacinta committed suicide. The entire nation knew of her humiliation. In the presence of majesty, she was so humiliated that she couldn't stand it, and she took her life. Humiliation can do that. Have you been able to grasp some of the big things in your life, and again, some of the small things that might make you feel humiliated? Maybe not in the presence of majesty, as in a king or queen, but humiliated in the majesty of the King of the universe, Jesus Christ. Where maybe we've said, Jesus, I will follow you. I will go where you say to go, and I'll do what you say to do. And Jesus, I commit myself to you. And then you find that you didn't do what you said, or the thing that you said you would stop doing, you're doing it again. And you're humiliated. I'd like to ask you all this morning to get out another card. And I'd like you to think with me this morning. Go ahead, everybody, and get out the card. And I'd like you to think with me this morning on what it is, if you were to say, here is the thing that I'm humiliated by, what is it? Now, for some, it can be, as I said, maybe some things that seem like small things, right? I said to God I'd read the Bible every day. And it's been a month since I read the Bible. I said to God, I will tithe to the church and I'll do missions, and now I look at it and I hardly give anything. Maybe it's with your parents, and you say, I'm not going to talk back and say mean things to my parents. And you're sitting here this morning and you know you did it last night. Sometimes it's bigger things. The person who said, you know, I will never commit adultery. I'm faithful and true. I'll never commit adultery. And you're sitting here and you say, Yet I did. Or the person who said, I got married and I committed to God that I'm married for life, no matter what. And now you're sitting here divorced. Or the guy in business who said, I know how easy it is to sort of slice the truth and to say things in business I shouldn't say. Lord, I'm never going to do that. And now you know you're sitting here this morning and you kind of do it, if you're honest with yourself, every week. For some, it's people who are really inspired. For example, many I know have been inspired by Francis Chan and his concept of crazy love, or David Platt and the book Radical, which we as a church went through. And it's like, Lord, we're going to be radical. We're going to be sold out. We're going to live totally for Jesus. And then you find yourself, well, I committed myself to this lifestyle, and it's too, I can't do it. Honestly, around the country right now, there's a whole group of what we call accidental Pharisees. People who said, yes, if you're going to be a true disciple of Jesus, you're going to be totally radical. And now you're finding, well, I can't be radical all the time, and I'm not doing it. And you become an accidental Pharisee when you hold up one way of living, but you live another way. And we come to the realization that sometimes it's easy to say yes, and then it's maybe hard to really follow up on that yes that we committed to. Can you relate to what I'm saying? That the real kind of Christ-like person that we want to be actually takes many ups and downs, and it's a character course. And on your card this morning, I would like you privately to write down, if you say there's one area of sin in my life right now where the word humiliation or shame or embarrassment fits me, here's that area and that word. And at the end of our teaching, I'm going to ask you to do some business with God about it. As we've been working our way through the Gospel of John, it has been so wonderful to see the way Jesus dealt with Peter. Let me remind you of a couple of things before chapter 21, some that we've talked about, some that we haven't had time to go with, too much in depth with. You see, Peter is a lot like many of us. He will commit himself to do something, not understanding what it really means that he's committing, and then he can't do it, and he's embarrassed, and as we're going to see this morning, humiliated. For example, in John 13, Jesus is having the Last Supper, the Passover feast, with his disciples, and he comes up to Peter, and he's going to wash their feet to show them what it means to be a servant. And as he comes up to Peter, and he says, I'm going to wash your feet, Peter says, no, you're not. And Jesus says, well, if I don't wash your feet, then you can't have anything to do with me. So Peter goes, well, then wash my whole body. And Jesus says, Peter, I don't need to wash the whole body. I can just wash your feet. Well, after that, Jesus talked to his disciples about love and how important that love was. And he then said to his disciples, he said, you know, I'm only going to be with you a little longer, and then you can't come with me where I'm going. So Peter, after the supper, He wants to talk to Jesus about that. So he says, Lord, where are you going? And Jesus says, where I'm going, you can't follow me now. You will later, but you can't follow me now. Peter says, well, Lord, why can't I follow you? Lord, I will lay down my life for you. And Jesus says, really? You'll lay down your life for me? Well, very truly, he says. I got to tell you something, Peter. Before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. And then that's kind of it. The supper ends, and as we talked about last week, Jesus goes along with Peter, James, and John across the Kidron Valley to the Garden of Gethsemane. He asks them to pray. They fall asleep. Then Judas shows up with the soldiers, right? They had lanterns, torches, and weapons. They drag Jesus across the Kidron Valley up to Caiaphas' house. Now, this is in April, probably early April, maybe late March, in the year 29 or 30 AD. We're not sure which one it is. And when they drag him up to Caiaphas' house, they're about to try him. Now, it's about 10 o'clock at night, as best we can tell by now, maybe 11. And Jesus is about to go through six trials. And in between these trials, he's going to be beaten, mocked, and flogged, and by 9 o'clock the next morning, he is put on the cross to die. So as he's brought into Caiaphas' house, and then Annas tries him, and then Caiaphas, and then the Sanhedrin, between the trials, he's lowered into the dungeon, and it's a house with a dungeon and a courtyard. That courtyard actually exists to this day. And so what happens is that John, who wrote the Gospel of John, he follows into that area, and because he's known by the soldiers and by the servant girls, they let him in, and then Peter comes, and Peter wants to get into that courtyard. So the servant girl at the gate says to him, "Aren't you one of those disciples who was with this guy?" And Peter says, no, not me. And he warms himself around the fire. In fact, if you'll look at the next picture, it shows you archaeologists have actually uncovered the exact place where all of this transpired. And these are the steps from the first century. The courtyard, as you look at the pictures, where the people are to the right. In fact, in that courtyard, they've established sort of a statue of this event. If you could just show that, Ken, next. So you have the Roman soldier, you have the servant girl, you have Peter, and notice the rooster on the top. Now it's cold. And so Peter is in there warming himself with the soldiers and the people talking. And as he's around the fire, some of the soldiers look at him and they say, "Hey, you're one of his disciples, aren't you?" And he says, "No, I don't even know the man." And time goes on, the trials are going on. And then finally, one of the high priest's servants, who was actually there when Peter, remember, Peter pulled out the sword and he cut off Malchus's ear, one of the soldiers. Well, one of his relatives is there and he sees Peter because he was there in the Garden of Gethsemane. He goes, "I know who you are. You're one of his disciples." Now, this is a series that's going on throughout the night, right? So by now it's probably 5 o'clock in the morning. And as soon as Peter says again, "I don't even know the man," the rooster crows. Mark tells us that Peter wept bitterly. Have you ever felt that way? Have you ever felt like, I'm going to be faithful to Jesus. I said I'd do this. I committed to do it. In fact, maybe you say, "I'm doing it," or "I'm trying to do it." And you look at your life and you say, I'm humiliated because I totally dropped the ball. Peter is one of the leaders in God's kingdom. And he's a very godly man. He, along with James and John, become the pillars of the early church. And then Paul gets added in later. And here is this guy that we would think is this really spiritual guy, but he struggles with failure and disappointment, just like you and me. And I am so glad the story is in the Bible, because we all need the encouragement to know when we blow it, how does God look at us? What kind of attitude does Jesus have? Now, throughout the night, as Jesus has gone through these trials, he's finally taken over to the Romans. Pilate tries Jesus but wants to let Jesus go, so he brings him before the Jews. The Jews don't want Pilate to let him go, so Pilate washes his hands, and he sends Jesus to be flogged one more time, and then Jesus is taken outside the city to a garbage area. It's actually a rock quarry. This is now a garbage area, and Jesus is crucified. He's on the cross from 9 in the morning until 3 o'clock in the afternoon on Friday. And the soldiers, John tells us, when the soldiers arrive to break the legs because of the Sabbath is coming, they pierce the side of Jesus, and he's already dead. Water and blood flow out. Several years ago, the Journal of the American Medical Association did an in-depth study on how Jesus would have died. And they concluded he died either by a heart attack or by suffocation, because after a while, you just can't keep pushing yourself up. But the good news is, in the gospel message, the thing that we build our lives around and we just celebrated as we had communion, is that Jesus did not remain dead. He rose from the dead, never to die again. He paid the price for your sins and mine. So on Sunday morning, he arose, never to die again, and unleashed on the world this wonderful kingdom of God. Now, for about a period of 50 days before he ascends to heaven, Jesus meets with his disciples. And the question before John chapter 21 is, How is Jesus going to respond to Peter after what Peter has done? So let's pick it up in 21, verse 1. Jesus appeared to his disciples again. This time it's by the Sea of Galilee. Simon, Peter, Thomas, and the whole crew is there. And it's early in the morning and they're fishing. So in verse 4, it says, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. He called out to them, Friends, do you have any fish? No, they answered. He said, Throw the net out on the right side of the boat, and you will get some. And when they did, they could not believe all the fish that they had. There is an area in the Sea of Galilee. In fact, if you'll just look at the next picture, it shows it to us. It's an area where there are a couple of streams. And the one stream is, as it comes into the Sea of Galilee, is cold, and one is warm. And there's a very strong tradition that that's actually the spot that they were at, because it fits everything. It wasn't populated, and it was the kind of area where Jesus could be making fish, and he could ask them to throw the net on the other side. And so what happens is Jesus has shown up. And they're in the north, they're in Galilee, they're fishing. And just by the fact that he shows up, you ought to realize one thing right away. It's about his grace to Peter. And he's about to speak kind words. In fact, he has told them to throw their net on the other side. And so all of a sudden in verse 7, when John, who's the disciple that Jesus loved, said, It's the Lord, Simon Peter wraps his outer garment around him. He jumps in the water. I'm not sure how all that works, but he jumps in all the water and he makes it for the shore. And Jesus says, come and get some of the fish that you got. And they actually record there was 153 fish. So Peter pulls in the fish. By the way, if you ever wonder, are these guys strong, muscular, rugged men? The answer is yes. 153 fish at 3 pounds each, if they're small fish. That's close to 500 pounds. So he is dragging the fish in, and Jesus says in verse 12, come, let's have breakfast together. Come and sit down. Now, none of his disciples dared say to him, who are you? Because all of a sudden they figured it out. Somehow, between his resurrection and his ascension, Jesus comes in and out, and sometimes they recognize him at first, sometimes they recognize him later, as the folks on the road to Emmaus' house did. Well, he's there, and he's with them. Now, think about a couple of things that he's doing. These guys have all been scattered, especially Peter. Peter has denied him, and Jesus shows up in the midst of that humiliation, and he has breakfast for them. He has fish and bread, and he asks Peter, with this miraculous catch of fish, to bring some more in. It's an environment of grace. So Jesus blesses the food, they eat the food, and you gotta imagine. I mean, imagine yourself that it's you in your sin and your humiliation. See, what we're about to see is not just what Jesus did with Peter, but it's the way God deals with you and me. Because he knows us better than we ever think. And when we make our statements and we say, count me in, Jesus, I'm for you, I'm going to do it. He knows that we want to do it, but he also knows we sometimes commit to things we can't do. Yet he still loves us. He's like a kind parent with a child overstating things and says, oh, I'm so glad you're making those statements. When you fall down on your face, I'm going to be there with you. And here's how it works. Verse 15, when they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Do you love me more? You said originally that even though everybody denies me, Simon, you won't. That you're different than other people. Do you really love me more than these other disciples? Yes, Lord, he said, you know I love you. Jesus starts it this way. By the way, here's the subtlety. He says, do you love me? And the word he uses for love, love with a committed kind of love. And Simon Peter goes, you know, Lord, I love you. I'm your friend. I'm attached to you. So Jesus says, feed my lambs. It's this Jesus still being with Peter for the original thing when he said, I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock, this confession of yours, I will build my church. Jesus is not reneging on any of that. So he says to him again, Simon Peter, do you love me with this totally committed love? Lord, you know that I love you like a friend. Ah, feed my sheep. Third time. Remember how many times that Peter has denied Jesus? One, two, three. Now Jesus is coming back. Do you love me? One, two, three. Third time, do you love me like a friend? Lord, you know I love you like a friend. And it hurts me that you're asking me this. But it's, again, it's in the context of grace. Where are they? They're on the Sea of Galilee. Does everybody remember when Peter was first called by Jesus where they were? Ah, come follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So he's, it's the place of his calling. He's recommissioning Peter. He's saying to Peter that his denial didn't surprise Jesus and it doesn't make Jesus ashamed of Peter. See, character change in you or me, it's slow. Now, our commitments and our telling the Lord we're going to do things, those are still important, right? Here's how it works, though, more often than not. We can commit to these things, but oftentimes the best thing we can do is to commit to the process of following Jesus with an awareness that we do it every day is a new day. Today, I'm going to follow Jesus. Today, I commit myself to the process of being in the Word, of being with other Christians in the church, of being in my home group. For some of us with major struggles, sin struggles, it's I commit to the process of the 12 steps because I've got this area of my life and I keep saying I'm going to change and I'm not changing. And so, Lord, I love you and I want to follow you, so I commit to the process of recovering from this thing. So now let's come back to your card. How about you? What's your area? What area of your life, if you were to say, this is an area of my life where I really relate to Peter, what is that area? The sins you're recommitting, or the person you said you wanted to be, but you're not yet. That humiliating part of your life. You and I must realize, sin and shortcomings, they're not good in God's eyes, but they don't surprise God about us. He knows how we're made. He knows how I am, and he knows how you are. And committing to him is a good thing. And to say, Lord, I'm done with this, it's a good thing. To commit wisely is a better thing. To say, Lord, I need your help, and I don't know how I'm going to get there, but I'm going to trust you, and I'm going to surrender to a process. I was with a Christian guy named Steve Arterburn. And he said, this is an area where a lot of people make a big mistake. We say, I'm gonna give up this sin. I'm going to turn it over to the Lord. And in fact, what we shouldn't do so much as give up the thing and turn it over to the Lord is we say to the Lord, I'm going to commit to a process of learning to overcome this thing with your help. By your people, by your grace, by good habits. And that's how God deals with us. So we get up every morning, and here's the reality. We get up every morning as sinful men and women on the path to being like Jesus, and Jesus is there offering us breakfast. He says, today is a new day. Today is the only day that matters. You can't do anything about yesterday, and you can't worry about tomorrow, but you have today, and Jesus is there offering you breakfast and sitting down with you, wanting to discuss what's on your card. And he wants you to take whatever that thing is, whatever that humiliation thing is, and he wants you to surrender it to him so that you can have hope knowing that God works with you, that Jesus works with you and me, even in our areas of sin and weakness. Would you all bow your heads with me this morning? Lord Jesus, as we come to you this morning, we come, Lord, each of us with our cards, areas where we said, Jesus, I'm going to follow you. And now we look at our lives, and to some extent, we didn't do what we said we'd do, or the thing we said we wouldn't do, we've done. And the first thing we do is we acknowledge that we've done that. We acknowledge that it's sin. And we ask God for your help. There are some here this morning who feel really bad about what they've done. There's some here this morning that probably should feel really bad, but don't. And so, Lord, all of us, we come to you now, and we ask, Lord, would you take our sin? Would you help us this week to take our card and to sit down and let Jesus sit down with us and have breakfast with us and to get recommissioned and set right with you? We pray this in Jesus' name.